This is almost, but maybe not every cost a seller might pay as closing costs in North Carolina. Every transaction is different, so you may pay more or less of these items depending upon what you agreed to do with the buyer when you signed your contract. The first thing is revenue or deed stamps or transfer fees. So this may have a lot of different names on your closing statement. Sometimes it's called excise tax, but what it is a fee that the Register of Deeds charges to sellers whenever you transfer property, and it's calculated by $2 per every $1,000 of your sale price. Another way to figure this out is take your sale price and divide by 500. You'll get the same number. Another seller closing cost is deed preparation or seller document preparation. Usually the buyer's attorney can do this for the seller, even though they represent the buyer, because it's done on a limited basis for the purpose of getting clear title to the buyer. But the seller can hire their own attorney if they want to, or they may need to because there's some conflict of interest where the attorney can't prepare those documents for the seller. The next thing is commissions. So the seller will pay both the listing agent and the selling agent's commissions as agreed upon in their listing agreement with their agent. This is a common misconception that sometimes people think that the buyer pays their own agent's commission. While that is possible sometimes, it has to be agreed upon in writing by the buyer. Otherwise, in your listing agreement, there's going to be a set percentage that you agree to pay as commission on your property. And then the listing agent splits that with the buyer's agent in an agreed upon amount. So sometimes, a lot of times in North Carolina, that number is set at 6%. That is negotiable, higher or lower, depending on the property and the circumstances. But the sellers do pay that commission unless they have agreed otherwise with the parties. The next thing a seller will pay is the payoff of any open loans that are secured by the property. So if you have a mortgage or an equity line, and that means there's an open deed of trust or two on the property, then that loan has to be paid off or else the buyer can't take clear title to the property. So you get a mortgage statement and you assume, oh, that's the amount that I owe. That's going to be the amount that's on my closing statement. Your payoff is always higher than what your mortgage statement shows because the payoff is good through a certain date past the closing date and includes an extra amount of interest called per diem interest for a set number of days. Now don't worry, anything that you overpay has to be returned to you by your lender within 30 days. So you should probably assume that you're going to overpay a few days worth of interest, but that will be refunded to you along with any escrow balance you may have. The next thing that will be addressed on the closing statement is prorations. So if the tax bill has not been paid for the year yet, then you will pay your portion of that year's tax bill on the closing statement. Same thing with HOA dues. So if there are any HOA dues that are due now, but you have not paid yet, say it's August 1st, the HOA bill was due for August, and by August 15th, you haven't paid it, you're going to be paying those first 15 days worth of HOA dues on your closing statement. Now, the opposite is also true. If you've already paid the taxes or your HOAs, then you will get a credit back from the buyer for their portion of the period that you paid in advance. Another thing that's part of sellers' closing costs is the HOA breakup fee. Now, this is actually called a transfer fee or a verification fee, but we call it the breakup fee in our office because it's what sellers pay to leave their HOA. And this is an administrative fee that addresses the time it takes for the HOA to verify that your dues have been paid and they don't have any liens on your property for unpaid HOA dues or for fines. Now, a recent North Carolina statute has imposed a cap on these fees at $200. And the reason why it's capped at $200 is because some of these fees were exorbitant. There were some that we would see $800, $900, and that does seem excessive, and that's because it is. So the North Carolina legislature stepped in and said, no, you can't charge more than $200 for this as administrative fee. And also, it imposed some limits on when rush fees can be charged. It used to be that some HOA management companies would charge rush fees for anything, any closing requests they received under 14 days from closing. Well, most attorneys only hear about the closing 14 days before the closing date, so nearly every closing was being charged a rush fee by the HOA companies. So now it's a much, much shorter time frame, I think 48 hours, but don't quote me on that. We'll have to look at the statute before a rush fee can be imposed. So if you live in a community with an HOA that has a transfer fee, keep an eye on these fees to make sure that they don't exceed the new cap. Another thing that a seller might, but not always pay, is seller paid closing costs. And these are any expenses of the buyers that you agree to pay in the contract. You see this in the contract in the portion where it says, seller agrees to pay however many dollars towards buyer's expenses. So whenever you get an offer on your property, you should look in that section to see whether the buyer is asking that you pay any of their closing costs. There are some other miscellaneous fees that don't appear on every closing, but they could appear on yours. For example, if there were any repairs that you agreed to make to your property that weren't completed before closing or that need to be paid at closing, those invoices may appear on your closing statement to be paid out of your proceeds. Other things are recording fees for documents that are not the deed. Typically, the buyer pays for the deed recording, but the seller may need to pay for recording fees for any powers of attorney that they needed to use, any free trader or separation agreements or trust certifications. Essentially, any document that needs to be recorded before the recording of the deed so that the seller can convey clear title to the buyer. Now, there's one thing you'll see on your closing statement that, while not a closing cost to you, it still appears as a line item that needs to be explained, and that's the due diligence fee. You're going to see the due diligence fee as a debit to you because it was paid to you at the beginning of the contract and it gets taken as a deduction towards the sale price. If this line item isn't shown as a debit to you, then you're effectively being paid your due diligence fee twice. While it doesn't happen often, sometimes there are not enough seller proceeds to cover the seller's closing costs. And when that's the case, the seller may have to bring money to closing to cover those closing costs. An example of this is, let's say the value of the property has decreased since you bought it, but you still owe a lot of money to the lender for your payoff. Well, your payoff plus the commissions may exceed the purchase price for the house. So that's when you most often see a seller have to bring money to closing because the lender does have to be paid in full unless you've negotiated with the lender to pay a lower amount. Again, this is not a list of every single thing that could ever appear on a seller's closing statement, but it is pretty detailed. So whenever you are about to sell your house or you've gone under contract, use this list as a way to get a really good idea of what you might be paying at the closing table. I've done other breakdowns on closing costs for both buyer and seller, so if you want to check it out, look at this video.